In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
Anything that would impede your word, we pray that you would move it. We understand that we stand in this sinful shell. Take our heart and mold it, dear gracious Father, that it might be receptive to your word. Pray now that you would encourage and empower us with courage claim truth. Now, God, if I stand with too much fear in my heart, give me courage. If I stare too arrogantly, I pray that you would humble me, remind me that I am nothing without thee. Then, Father God, when we've done all that's assigned to our name and we can do no more, tongue can tell no more, receive us in glory. We might be able to spend our time in eternity with thee. In Jesus' name we give you this prayer. Amen. Amen. We are here and beginning the new month. This month, our theme is putting feet on faith. Putting feet on faith. In other words, we want our faith to be active. We want our faith to be active. You say you believe in God, but do you live like you believe in God? You say you trust the Lord, but do you live like you trust the Lord? So when we look at this text and we're still in the book of Ephesians, the first chapter, we want to take another look at Paul's prayer for the Ephesians as he closes chapter 1. We want to walk into this text with our hearts and our minds and our eyes wide open. We might hear what the Lord has to say for us. Would you stand with me as I read for you from the King James Version, Ephesians chapter 1, 15 through 19. 15 through 19. Amen. And it reads, "Wherefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, and the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power." Let me read that one more time. Verse 19. "What is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power?" You might be seated in the presence of the Lord. When I stood before you last, we looked at 15 through 18, and we asked the question, do you know the Lord? And we found that we are only know the Lord through an endowment of his Holy Spirit. Listen to the text. He says, and he talks to us about knowing God through the wisdom, the spirit of wisdom and revelation. In other words, a lot of us, we believe we know God, but we have not the Spirit of God. We go through the motions of coming to church. We go through the motion of even saying our prayers and our blessings over our food. But have we honestly and earnestly surrendered to the will and the power of God? He opens up in verse 15 when he begins to pray for the children. He says, you know, I'm excited about your faith in Jesus. I'm excited about your belief, your trust in Jesus. And one of the things that we need to be mindful of about faith, we were listening to one of the preachers at Ridgecrest, and he made it so plain that you just have to really think about what he said. He says, faith is taking a risk. And if you would take your Bible and read through the faith text and replace the word faith with risk, you would give yourself the definition or the essence of what it really means to have faith. Risk is the substance of things hoped for. When you play the lottery, you don't know what's going to happen. You take a risk. But there's no real risk in God, because your faith eradicates the risk that you're willing to take. And so when we look at this text through the course of the remainder of this month, I need you to ask the question personally. I need you to apply the concept, the principle personally. Is my faith in God or in me? Is my faith in God or in me? There's an illustration, and I share with Andre that I would use him and his family this morning to introduce my message. We celebrated Naomi's 21st birthday on Friday. Yeah. Naomi is our miracle baby. Angie was in Washington, D.C., July 24th, 21 years ago today. She was standing on the corner at a conference, an education conference, and she went into labor on the street, away from home, no family, out of touch. They rushed her to the hospital. They had to deliver Naomi prematurely. She was 3 months premature. Andre gets to the hospital. Doctors say that the chances of her surviving next to none. Andre begins to, he checks on Angie, and the Lord speaks, and he answers.
All right.
During the course of the next 3 months, with Angie in the hospital in D.C., Andre trying to take care of home here, there came a time when he had to go and be with Angie in Washington, D.C. He knows nobody. There's no family there. He's in the hospital, and there's no room at the Ronald McDonald House. There's a person in the congregation that had some people there that were willing to take Andre in. And these people don't know Andre. But at the word of a member here, they not only give him the keys to their house, but they also give him the use of their automobile. Andre, at the particular time that this is going on, struggling on his job because he doesn't have the time to take off. And he's threatened to lose his job. Not once did he stop trusting that God would provide. But he believed that God would provide. He didn't have it, but he gave. And the thing that is so awesome, it reminded me of the text in Luke where he says, if you give unto him, I'll give back to you. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. That's faith. When Andre was able to see Naomi, stand up, Naomi. He sent me a picture of his hand and her hand holding to his pinky finger. He could hold Naomi in one hand. all of her organs were underdeveloped. Kept trusting, kept believing. And today we celebrate 21 years. Most of us are looking everywhere else for a miracle or for an example of faith. And I submit to you, all you have to do is look at the person sitting next to you. Because even if that person next to you does not have faith in God, God has faith in them. Too many times we're trying to explain and teach you how to have faith in God. God has had enough faith in everyone in this room that he loved us enough that while we were in our sin and mess, he died. He surrendered everything for you and I. And yet, we don't have enough trust in him to even come on a Sunday morning. We're too busy. We're too busy trying to live and do life rather than living. The Bible says, if you come unto me, I will give you life, give it to you more abundantly. So let's look at the text. The first thing, and I submit to you, the first issue that we have with faith is that we are looking at a natural faith and not a supernatural faith. He says to us, first and foremost, in Paul's prayer to the Ephesians, he says, I'm praying that the Spirit of God would fall upon you that you might receive wisdom and revelation. Wisdom is the use of what I have heard and learned and seen for myself. Revelation is that the curtains have been pulled back and I can see what was behind it. And many times what happens with us is that God has already set the victory for us,
all right,
but he has placed a curtain between us and the victory. And he is waiting for us to pull back the curtain that he might reveal to us the victory in our lives.
Yes, yes.
But you know what keeps us from pulling back the curtain that we might receive the revelation of God before us? Is we don't have the faith of God to reach out to the curtain and pull it back. We want God to come down out of glory and pull back the curtain and show us what he already has for us without any investment on our part. You see, the thing that you need to be mindful of is that if you're going to risk on the stock market, you've got to put something in. And many of us don't want to put nothing in, but we want to get everything out. Oh, I stopped by to share with you. You need to take a risk on God. You need to be able to understand that if I'm going to live in the power of God, I've got to have faith in him. And it's not faith in what I can see him doing, but it's faith in what I know he's able to do. Y'all gonna work with me? The Hebrew boy stood before the fiery furnace.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And they told the king, he said, listen, even if I'm consumed by fire and my God does not deliver me, that does not mean that he is not able. We believe that he is able in spite of what people say about us. Do you believe that he's able? Or do you believe that he's a impotent God? No power. Do you believe that the situation and the circumstances that you're going through right now are so overwhelming that your God does not have a chance at helping you? I stopped to share with you on my way to Heaven Gates, you're not walking in the power of God. You're walking in the understanding of man. And you need to know that God has a way of working things out when you can't work it out. I got it. Y'all, excuse me, this is not a burlesque show. I'm just making an adjustment. Oh, I see the greeter. She jumping up to come in to see what's going on. Amen. Listen, let's work on the text. One of the things that we need to be mindful of is that the challenge for us is that we have been given a definition of faith that is it requires us to do something. It requires us to demonstrate something. But when the writer of the Hebrews says to us that faith is the substance of things hoped for. In other words, it's not what you do that makes the difference, but it is how you believe that makes the difference. That's why there's little trust in relationships, because we go along with connecting, but we never get to the point of believing. We want to accuse one another, but we don't want to trust one another. We want to mold one another,
all right.
But we don't want to accept one another. So when God asks us to have faith in him, how can we have faith in a God that we don't see? My daddy abandoned me and never once tried to see me. And my Father in heaven says that I will supply all of your needs. My earthly father has abandoned me. How? Is a father that I've never seen going to be able to supply for me? Then my earthly father refused to supply for me. But when I think on the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, when I was on my way to hell, he sent somebody by the way. It wasn't my biological father, but it was a father nonetheless. And he walked with me. He talked with me. And he told me that I am his own. He didn't have much going on in the way of position, but he had a great deal of love that he shared with me. He had confidence in me. And he shared that confidence with me. The first thing we need to be mindful of is that faith is not in all that I'm able to do, but faith is in how far am I willing to trust. Faith is in how I approach the challenges that are before me and the lack of understanding that is within me. A lot of times we go through challenges in our life and we want to have all of the answers. We need the recipe to be able to see how to go through and how to navigate this thing. Paul in his prayers teaching us, it's not how much you know, but it's how much God already knows about you and your situation. Listen to what Paul said. He says, I'm praying that you would receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation. In other words, he's saying to us, this understanding that you need is not from the books that you have studied. It's not from the teachers that you have sat under, but it's from the spirit that God has endowed within you. It is a supernatural spirit that allows you to see things that are not on the surface, but you might be able to see beneath what is going on. He calls it in the fourth chapter of 1 Corinthians, a discernment, a discerning spirit. There's something that just ain't quite right about so-and-so. Or you have a feeling that you know that this is the right thing to do. I may not have all the answers. I may not have all the details, but there's something within that has shared with me that I don't have to worry about tomorrow. I got a good feeling about this thing. But you need to understand that you can't have that feeling without faith. You see, the problem with us in church today is that we got it backwards. We want the feeling and then the faith. There's no faith when feeling comes first. Because when your feelings get in the midst of it, it messes it all up. Because now your feeling might make you miss an opportunity that God has put in front of you. But when you're willing to take a risk on Jesus, listen to the text. He says, "Yeah, I'm just excited about your faith in Jesus. Jesus sacrificed it all that we might be able to appreciate and to live within all that he has." Can I get to the text?
Yes.
Walk with me in the text.
Yes, Mom.
Am I walking in the power of God? Or am I walking on the rumors of God? You see, a lot of us have heard about the blessings of God. I could come even in this room, I don't have to leave this room, and I can just point out different ones in this room and just simply ask for a testimony, and you'll be able to see just what the faith of God will do. It may have been the faith of the individual, and it may have been the faith of the loved ones of the individual. But you can see that right here in the room. But the question is, what is it that activated the faith that delivered them from what they were going through? Listen to the text. Let me read it. Verse 19. He says, "And what is the exceeding greatness of his power who us were? Who believe according to the working of his mighty power?" Now, don't miss this. Paul has to use four words to describe the power of God. Because one just ain't enough. Look at this thing. He says, the greatness of his power. The Greek word dunamis, where we get the word dynamite. As a matter of fact, the first thing we need to realize that the power of God will blow your life away. You need to understand that when he lights his spirit in your life, he blows up all the mess and the junk. In other words, God has to blow you apart before he puts you back together. That's power. Because some of us have held on to our hellacious situations so long that it ain't nothing but a stick of dynamite is able to blow us free from what we're going through. So the first word that he uses is he uses a stick of dynamite to blow your world apart. Because he's going to use his power to put it back together again. Y'all going to pray with me? Look at this thing. One of the things that we don't realize is that a lot of the brokenness that we go through in life is God demonstrating to us that we're living without him. Or we're living in an opposite direction of which way he wants us to go. So what he's doing, he's navigating the brokenness in your life to get you to either turn around or look to him. Because if you don't turn around, you're going to go continually in a downward spiral. But if you don't turn around and you look to him, he'll reach down and grab you where you are. But you've got to realize that you ain't got it all together. You've got to realize that God wants something from you, that you invest in him, because he's already made the investment in you. Second thing, when we look at that text, he says, how do I walk with God in the power of God? He says, I've got to understand, not only does he blow my life up, but look at this thing. He says, his power to us were who believe. Now look at this thing. You want to do this? You've got to believe that he is who he says he is, and he will do what he says he will do. When you talk about the word believe, you also talk about the word confidence and trust. I trust that God will make a way. I may not understand the way that he's making, but I'm trusting that he's going to make a way. And I'm going to make sure that when I hear the direction that he's calling me in, I'm going to follow in that direction. Many of us say we believe, but we always excuse the struggle in our lives not to live what God has asked us to live. And so the challenge that we need to be mindful of is that, first and foremost, he blows up the folks' lives that believes in him. Now, isn't that crazy? That's crazy. I believe and trust in him, and he's going to blow my life up. You meddling this morning. But he does. He blows it up in order to get our attention. Look at this thing. He says, now, it didn't say anything about the sinner on the street. It didn't say nothing about the politician that lied to you.
All right.
He says he's using his power, the greatness of his power, works in those that believe. Look at this thing.
All right.
He says, according to the working, that's another word. They use the word here, working, energia. It is the word that is it it tells us that God is moving. He is making things happen. See, one of the things that we don't understand is that we don't have faith in God because we're lazy. You're going to be a child of God. You've got to work through the Word. You can't just run through the Word. Paul uses four different words to describe the power of God, and one of them is an action word that says that my faith leads me to do something. I got faith in God, and I'm going to sit in my house and wait till He gets here. I don't have faith. I have faith in God, and I just know that He's going to make a way out of no way, but at the same time, I'm not trying to get out of the way. You got to do something. He says that it is the working. What is the working? It's the Spirit of God that is moving in me and on me. It is that uncomfortableness what I find when I'm looking in the mirror of life and I see something about me that I'm not comfortable with, but I'm not willing to do anything about it. Power of God. Look at this thing. What does He and why does He send His working power on us? Most of us will sit in worship and we'll say, well, listen, so-and-so ought to have been here because the preacher was talking to him this morning. The preacher was talking to her this morning. Have you looked at the mirror? Did you see so-and-so in your mirror this morning? Or did you see a reflection of what you thought you were? Look at this thing. I'm not going to be much longer. I know this ain't exciting news. He says, look at this thing. According to the working of His mighty, His mighty power. That's katros, the Greek word katros, meaning that it is overpowering, invincible. His mighty power. You know, a lot of us, we will trust in everything else. We trust in our jobs. We trust in the homes. We put in the security doors and the security system. And we spend extra money, and they still break in. But when you put the security system of the Holy Spirit in your life, no force from within or without can destroy the mighty power of God that He has placed in your life. The mighty, it is an overpowering word of God. One of the things that destroys the mighty power of God is worry. I'm going to talk about that next week in detail. But Warren Wiersbe uses an illustration of Rockefeller, who was the first billionaire in the country. And he had doctors all around him because he had plenty of money, but he was always sick. As a matter of fact, he would eat on a diet of milk and crackers because his stomach was so jacked up. And all of the money that he had could not resolve his problem with his stomach. You know why he was worried? He was worried that somebody was going to come and take all his money. But when Rockefeller met Jesus, he became one of the greatest philanthropists in our country. You know, that's a big fancy word of saying he became a great giver. And when he began to give, because of the power of Christ, he was able to live. It's an awesome thing that he took the worry off of him and took the doctors out of his life because he met the doctor. Look at this thing. The last word that he talks about in that text, he says to us, according to the working of his mighty, and then he goes right back to power. Now, I need for you to be mindful here, because when we read the English language here, we see that you say, preacher, well, that's the same word as he says, the greatness of his power. But when you move down, it says power, but he uses a different word for power here from the first word that he says in power of the dynamite power. He uses this word as Issachus. Issachus is a power that is eternal. It is long lasting and hard hitting. It is a continuous power. It is a sustaining power. It is a keeping power. See, the thing that you need to be mindful of is, first, God blows up your life. Then he works with the broken pieces of your life. Then he covers you with the protection of his life. And then finally, he keeps you when you can't keep yourself. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that I've been going through, all that I'm going through, and all that I will go through, I know that my Redeemer lives because he keeps me. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, my soul, my mind, and my power come from on high, because the power of God keeps me when I walk with him, when I talk with him. You know, it's a funny thing that we can walk with somebody a mile or two and not say a word to them. And I'm reminded when Jesus was raised from the dead. And he had left Calvary. Yes. But he was on his way to Jerusalem. But he met two brothers. And they were on their way to Emmaus. As a matter of fact, the reason they were leaving and going to Emmaus was because Jesus was crucified. This is the thing that just blows me away, Judah.
All right.
These were two disciples of Jesus Christ, believers of Jesus Christ. Jesus healed on the cross. And they're leaving the church. Jesus comes and walks with them for a little while and shares with them the word of God. Now, what does that say? There's a whole lot of us will be discouraged because of the situation, the circumstances in life. They may even draw you or drive you from the church. But Jesus, in his awesome power, loves you enough to walk the opposite way with you to bring you back to the right way. And a whole lot of us don't let shame take you down the road that you don't want to go. Because the same direction, these brothers, listen to these brothers, and they're talking about Jesus. Then Jesus finally leaves them. Did not our hearts burn within us as he explained to us Scripture? You know why we can't walk in the power of God? Because we are not explaining the word of God to give you an understanding of how to walk in the power of God. The power of God is not in a book. The power of God is in your heart. Listen to the prayer that Paul prayed. He prayed that the Spirit might be within us. When he opens up the book of Ephesians, he says that it is our relationship in Christ that makes the difference. The question that we ought to ask ourselves, am I in Christ? If I'm in Christ, I'm walking in the power of God. Paul went on to say it like this, the life that I now live, no longer my own, but it is the life hid in Christ Jesus. Are you in him? Are you out? The doors of church are open. Would you come? Would you come? Would you come? Would you come? Trusting and believing that God will make a way out of no way. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? Listen. You may not have looked in the mirror this morning, but you ought to quietly look in that mirror right now as we speak. We were in Ridgecrest. We're on the mountain.
Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at lwbcindy. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you, and remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.